Alright, you feather merchants. This video is about a couple of more stories I have about those early years as an iron worker working out of local 395. And the first one I want to say is this happened in the 50s, around 57, 58. I was in high school. And I remember my dad, of course, he was an iron worker. He came home early, and I could see something was bothering him. And he told me about what he just witnessed. And he was running a job at U.S. Steel for American Bridge in Gary, Indiana, and in the steel mill. And they were working up on the roof, and there was an opening in the roof. I think they might have been replacing the sheets up there. Anyway, he said they had this apprentice just hire in. He was 18 years old, and for some reason, the apprentice was working, walking on the crane walkway underneath them. And what you have is in these mill buildings, you have overhead cranes in them, and on either side you got a walkway there. And this is one of the older steel mill buildings, so I believe that about every 20 feet there'd be a column. And you have a wall, and then you have a column about every 20 feet. And since it was an old building, there was probably only around 6-inch clearance between the face of the column and the overhead crane. And my dad said they saw the kid walking on the walkway, and the crane is behind him. And evidently there was a lot of noise, and they could see the kid was not aware of the crane coming up behind him. And so they all started yelling at him. And the kid never, he didn't hear anyone yelling because there was so much noise in the building. And my dad said when the young apprentice, when he got right next to the column to walk around the column there, the crane came in, was running down the tracks, and it hit him. And when it hit him, it squashed him. He was squashed between the crane and the face of the column, and he said his brains popped right out of his head. I mean, it was really ugly. He died instantly, but what a horrible death. And it was actually one of the few times I ever saw my dad cry. And anyway, that's one story. And then I remember my when I got out of the Marine Corps, that first job that I went on, I was I had to go down to the trailer where the superintendent was, because I had to fill out something for taxes, you know, like some kind of form, tax form, I think it was. So a guy named Wally, he was running the job, really squared away. I was working with, he was a Serbian, and most of the crew were Serbian or Croatians, and they were working out of they were all from Local 1, Chicago, and they were working in our jurisdiction because there was so much work there back then. Anyway, while I'm in the trailer, you know, I'm brand new, and the foreman brings this guy in, and I later realized he was one of the South Chicago crew that happened to be on the job as a friend of Wally's. And evidently, this guy was standing on the edge of the building, like at the apex of the building, and he kept looking down, and he wasn't working. And so the foreman brought him into the trailer because there's something wrong with him, right? So Wally said, what's your problem? And the guy said, I keep hearing voices. And Wally asked him, he said, well, what do the voices tell you? He said, well, I keep hearing this voice that tells me to jump. He said, Wally told him, he said, well, why the fuck don't you just jump? Get back up in the on the building and stop acting stupid. So anyway, I'm watching this. I thought, this is almost like being back in the Marine Corps. And anyway, and then I have one other story to tell you. It's we were working on BOF, the basic oxygen furnace at Inland Steel. And like I previously said, that was a big building. This a job like this, it lasts a few years to put the steel up and sheet it and everything. So, and all the machinery that goes inside of it. So you're working on this building for a few years. And anyway, Harry the Horse, he was the foreman, or I think he was like at least the general foreman. Maybe he was a superintendent in charge of all the structural steel going up. And my dad actually was the one that had the sheeting. He was running the sheeters. Where they did all the roofing, the sidewalls, and that. Anyway, one of the foremen of one of the gangs, I don't want to say his name, but his nickname was Wedgehead. And Wedgehead, if you ever saw him without a helmet, you'd see why they called him Wedgehead. He was a big guy, and he had aspirations of being a politician. I don't know. I know he used to run for local counselor jobs, positions. And I don't know if he ever made it or not. But anyway, during this time, he was a foreman of one of the ironworker gangs that was underneath Harry the Horse. And Harry came to him and said that he had to lay off his gang. It might have been on the tail end of the job. I can't remember. All I remember is that he was going to lay off Wedgehead's gang. And so normally when, and of course, Harry the Horse, he gives Wedgehead an envelope with all the checks in it. So normally what guys would do, if you're a foreman and the general foreman gives you the checks to your gang, they tell them ahead of time, they give them the checks, and they give them time and at quitting time to get their stuff together so they can, they have a little free time to get everything together, and they're going to go, they're going to leave. Well, anyway, Wedgehead decided not to tell the people who were working for him that they were going to get laid off. So Wedgehead made him work all the way up to regular quitting time. And then he tells him, he says, I got to let you guys go. And this is coming down from the top, and I got your checks here. So they're looking at him, and Wedgehead opens up the envelope and he starts handing out their checks. And then all of a sudden he's looking like in disbelief because his name is on one of the checks. And Harry the Horse was laying him off with the rest of them. And of course the guys in the gang right away, they saw what was happening. They all got a big kick out of that one. It was fun being an iron worker back then. Besides, of course, it was really dangerous. And you know, one thing I want to say real quick is about that job being really dangerous. I mean, there were times during that 15 years where I would pray to God that he wouldn't let me fall. You know, I mean, some of the jobs, like working with a helicopter setting iron, that happened one time. I think the job lasted about 10 days when I was doing that. And every day I went to work, I thought, oh my God, please don't let me die. And that I felt fear like I've never felt before in my life. And it wasn't like that all the time. I mean, sometimes you'd have jobs, you're on the ground moving machinery, doing various things, welding, and you didn't have that fear factor. But there were times where I always did believe in God, and I believed in Jesus, and even from when I was a little kid, you know, when I remember saying my prayers. And anyway, I left 395 and went to the Nevada test site, and that was a dream job for iron workers, and I never felt any fear there. I was a wonderful job, 10 years. And then, of course, I ended up in Pelican Bay for 16 years, and I loved that job. That was really a good job. And but there were tough moments where you felt fear. We had a lot of mass violence that I experienced, and where inmates would be attacking each other with weapons, and of course we'd have to respond to them and use our batons, gas, whatever to break the fights up, and you would feel fear. I felt fear. There were times where I felt fear, but it was for a short period of time. Except I remember the big riot, you know, the 2000 riot. That lasted a half hour, and that was no joke. That was that was serious. You got to figure there was about 300 convicts. They're all fenced in, and we had eight buildings on B Yard and eight gunners, and all eight gunners, they're introducing rubber rounds into the yard, and they're introducing gas, and then they started shooting into the yard with Mini 14s. And besides that gunfire, you had the tower gunner. You know, he's on the other side of the buildings, and he's shooting into the yard. And then I remember during the riot, what it caught my eye. I saw several correctional officers with rifles running from the area of the gun tower on the roof, and they all laid down and aimed their weapons inside the yard. Now, I haven't got time to watch what they're doing or what they're not doing. I have no idea if they fired from up on that roof, but I knew that, of course, the gunners in the building, they were shooting Mini 14s, and the tower gunner was. And every 3 months we would qualify with all our weapons. And there were times where I would see people when they're using the Mini 14, they maybe missed their target and hit my target, or just missed their target and my target. And this is under no stress. And you're talking about a target that's not moving, and it's a paper target. And I thought during this riot, and then you got take into consideration, there was about 300 convicts out there, and at least 100 of them had weapons, and they're stabbing each other, and all this is going on. And I was smart enough to know that those Mini 14 rounds, when they hit the ground, it's not like they all of them go into the ground. A lot of them will ricochet. And I kept thinking, the half hour I'm out there, I thought, there's a good chance that one of these bullets is going to hit me, you know. And anyway, it never did, and they never turned on us. None of the inmates turned on us. But it was a fear that I felt during that half hour. But I am telling you, there was nothing like the fear that I felt as an Ironworker. Even when I was in Afghanistan, I never felt fear in Afghanistan. I was there 2.5 years, and even when I got lost, to me it was a joke, you know. I felt a little concerned until I found out there was a base there I could go to, you know, when I was lost. But even when they would, the Taliban would fire rockets into our base, I never felt fear. I got pissed off. I used to pray that they would breach that wall because I wanted to kill the son of a bitch for waking me up. But the fear I felt as an Ironworker, I was actually on jobs where you felt that fear 8 hours a day, and sometimes it would only last a day or a couple days, and sometimes it would last a week or more. And anyway, that's my story, and I want to thank you, Feather Merchants, for stopping by, and I'll see you boys and girls on the next video. All right.